You grew up in Ajmer, and again and again in your work from 1989, which is Om Dar-Ba-Dar. Sorry, you grew up in Ajmer, and again and again in your work, Om Dar-Ba-Dar is 1989.
From
87. From 87 onwards, and this is last year. You've return to Ajmer Pushkar in different ways, and every time there has been the Mela. So I was thinking that, yes, I mean, a Mela, which is like this big fair, which is chaos, which is something disruptive, it becomes too easy a word, but is it something that the fairground does it reveal something? Does it plunge us into something? So in Om Dar-Ba-Dar, I was thinking actually Om overwrites the Mela. It's his story. He changes Pretkund, the Mela. He makes his own mythology of that landscape. The science lab and Pretkund and Ajmer and Pushkar are actually a backdrop where he inscribes himself. And then in Image Meets a Shadow, you take your very young children as though to see a Mela that they have seen. And maybe if they want to claim this place for their own where you have grown up. And there's a certain gentleness in the introduction there, and that Mela is a place of opportunity and also an introduction to these young children of worldliness or duniyadari. So you see that liaisons are made here, which are business and personal, and that's how the Mela sort of opens up. And now it's like you have gone with this young crew, and in a way by yourself, there is no mediating layer. And these three books, which if I can quote, I mean not quote the books, but name them, Joseph Campbell, I think, because I was thinking also that the idea of the Mela is a bit like maybe Campbell's idea of the threshold, which is like between worlds and is able to take you from one world to the layer of towards the other. Kalaso, who has written about different mythologies, including Puranic mythology, and who's telling you seems to like a lot, and you've quoted again and again in this film. And Canetti, Ilias Canetti, who talks about crowds, and maybe it's a way of trying to figure out how to shoot these crowds. But effectively, you've constructed the Mela, and it seems to me that you let us see everything. Like, the main thing is that everything in the Mela has to be seen by us long enough and without fear, as though something might reveal itself in looking long enough. And the one thing that you do is you go to some of these threshold sort of spaces, like the nights where it's empty and this huge machinery is going to take us to the other world, or the woman who's also is a man, and a woman who's so tender with the pigeons and who's so abusive to the policeman. Mythology also, therefore, we can carry on listening to it, and then we come to that slightly uneasy place where the queen is sleeping with this dead horse. So that's the experience I felt while watching the film. How do you see your gaze over the years, which has been like 30, 40 years? Has it? Do you feel the change? And of
stories that I wanted to crack, which are the basis of Pushkar. So, and after Om Dar-Ba-Dar, I was writing another script called Om in the Satellite City. And there I was seeing Pushkar after 50 years. And it was a science fiction kind of a thing. And there, there I was creating my own lake that I will find a different fiction for this lake, which is not part of the, say, that So the first theme is like myth market and the myth and the mouth, which is carrying it. So the Pushkar has this myth that the Brahmā doesn't have a place for his worship. So he tells other gods that I want a place for myself. So he throws a lotus, it falls on the earth, it bounces thrice, three lakes emerge, you know. And then they all come down and the Brahmā blesses the water that anybody who dips in the water will go to the heaven because he'll be cleaned of his bad karmas. So once they come down here, so, and it's a yajna, you know, and so if they come down, so if it's a yajna, so it means you have to, people will come because there'll be catering, there'll be transport system, there'll be lodging, boarding, so a kind of a market will grow around yajna, you know, that is the basic thing. And then, so a market grew around this yajna to cater to the gods. Now, gods are, means they are always foreigners, you know. They come, either if they come from heavens or it could be the white people coming from the Europe or Israelis or anybody, you know. So, then what happened, the people started dipping and they started going to the heavens straight. So, the heavens got overpopulated. So, when they got overpopulated, so the gods got, you know, like worried that there's no place and the whole karma system, account system is failing because nobody's doing any good karmas because they'll kill and go and wash and go to the heavens. So, you have to restore the system because the system is deteriorating. You know. So, the Brahmā said, I can't take my blessings back, but there is a solution. So, what I'll do is pick this Pushkar and I'll keep it in the sky. You know, back. So, only for the 5 days you'll be able to call it back on the earth. And once it comes down, that 5 days the waters will turn holy and you'll have the same power of cleaning your karmas, you know. So, now what I was questioning is that, so the real Pushkar is in the sky, you know. The real Pushkar is in the sky, and so what remains behind when the Pushkar goes back to the heavens, you know, or the in the sky? So I call that an image because I have a theory that image is imagination. It is not a tangible thing. So what is material expression of it is the shadow. So what remains is the shadow, you know, Pushkar. And this, over the year, it's a shadow, and the real image is Pushkar in the sky, which is an idea basically, because image has no physical form, you know. I mean, when even if you imagine a thing like a house or something, you will notice that you don't have any concrete image in your head. It is a feeling of an image, you know. I mean, there's no actual concrete, tangible image when you imagine, you know. It's just a feeling of it, you know. So this was one I want to crack, you know, this image. So I keep trying to crack this image, you know. The second image is of Brahmā story called Fifth Head, which is the Brahmā creates this girl, daughter, and she stands in front of him and he is looking at her. There's a gaze. So she gets frightened, you know. So she shifts. So one head emerges. She again shifts. One head emerges. She shifts. So one head emerges. And so he has covered her in terrestrially in odd direction. She can't escape his gaze, you know. So she flies off, you know. So a fifth head emerges to scan the skies like we have, you know, satellites and, you know, like multi-cameras and yebo. So there is a Shiva's adolescent avatar, Batuk. He can't see it, you know, because it's a play of the nature. But he can't see. He says there's an old man lusting for this little girl, you know. You can say anything, you know, like, I mean, people said Brahmā is a pedophile and, you know, like, yeah, on you. So he chopped his head so that skull got stuck to his hand. And because of that, so he then, he gets rid of the skull. You have this figure kind of in, even in Karnataka, And you have this mountain which are called Brahmagiri, where they'll say that the skull fell there, you know. And because of the Brahmahatya, the Shiva had to do some kind of a penance. So this story was the text I've used from the classics. So I want to crack that myth. What is it, you know? Is it sociological thing or is historical imagination? So I want to crack that. The third thing is, we have taken Ashwathama, you know. And the Gayatri getting purified from the guts of a cow, you know. So how is it possible? So I have various versions that maybe Shiva turned into a grass first, you know. Then the grass was fed to the cow. Oh, why cow, you know? So I had asked somebody that what does it mean that the Gayatri was purified by the process through the cow, you know? So one person said, you know, cow meant, this thing meant that she went through the gamut of life, you know. So I want to decode these images. So every time I go there, I have some ideas. But this time I was looking for it, but I wasn't desperate to crack or find the meaning of it. But I was understanding for my own understanding, not for the film. But my pleasure in this making this film was that I had this inspiration, because I love the Robert Clasio's text so much that I was looking for an opportunity to just put his text in a film, you know. So there was this opportunity where I could put his text, and I wanted to create this Pushkar like a shadow where nobody lives. Everything is gone or disappeared or evaporated, that kind of a feeling. So you see this woman and monkeys living there, you know. And slowly the people descending or coming down. And so I couldn't really crack it. But one of the research, you know. But the kind of image in the Woman, the satellite, was that I've used the Pretkund, where this women are exercised, like a space craft, where the steps open up like the wing of a spacecraft, and they open in the Brahmalok, where the Lord Brahma lives, you know. And what Lord Brahma does, actually Lord Brahma is the boy's father, what he does, that he kidnaps every Mela time, the Miss Pushkar, you know, and they take them to this Brahmalok and they turn them into mermaids. Now the idea is, if you don't have water, but if you have a fish, it will give you water. Like if you have a water, there'll be a fish. So it's a different that. So through mermaids, they create this waterworks which supplies the water to Pushkar. You know, that was my fiction, and various. In what happens in that, the when the Batuk kills his own father, so the son Batuk changes into his own father, you know. So something like that, you know. But I think most of the things are in mind, you know, like don't see much, you know.
And how you work with sound, like in this film, often like the image, the image of a single person or two people, and the sound is like vast.
Since I couldn't crack in the images, sound I was in control. So, I mean, with sound, if you have, with image, if you have nice sound, so I tried my best to make it more hypnotic, mesmerizing. So I used these soundtracks from this NASA recordings of the planets, you know, they are haunting, you know. And of course, the sound has its own narrative, like baby crying or, idea of the cow crying. So in sound design, there is a parallel kind of a narrative happening, which is trying to, whatever is missing in the image, it's trying to evoke it.
Tell us more about the narrative of the sound.
Even in the pool of the spirit, in the beginning where the exercising has happening, so there'll be many ideas, like child being born, or the spirits entering, or invoking the planets, because they're talking about the Pitralok and the travel or traveling to the other world, you know. So small ideas about the sound, and you, as if it's a narrative, you know, it's a narration, you know.
Of the ritual or of the incantation is giving you a sound.
My narrative would be the feeling I want to or I have as a child looking at, because I'm fascinated by that Pret Kund, you know, pool of a spirit. Because I go every time I go that place, and I've lived there also in like in Omdarbadar also, the suicide or the death, that ritual takes place in the Pret Kund. So I have my personal fantasies, or creative fantasies, or creative, you know, concoctions or delusions I've built for myself. So the shadow and the image idea, host and the ghost, that idea, the body and some spirit has taken the possession over this womb. The panda is saying that leave. He said, no, I won't leave. I won't leave. Before that, you have said about that, okay, you this is for your ancestors, they should be happy. But there, this person is saying, you know, that spirit is saying, I just don't want to leave. I just don't want to leave. They're saying that somebody else has taken a position about it. So this idea about the ghost and the host. So I have, there's this emotional response to this idea. Or this woman getting exercise, you know. So, or the idea of, is it, and the rebirth, baptizing, the old man is like Brahmā for me, you know, his arms are like those twigs, you know. So, the sound is a, my strong response, emotional response to that place, which I have been meditating over a period of 40 years. You know.
We'd leave questions.
Huh?
$25 lakhs. Time. I hope it covers his money. I'm trying to sell it. I mean, you make money, you know, it's not a government film. We are those producers. We have invested about 25 lakhs or 30 lakhs. So we want to make money.
I have a question. Yeah, the moment you mention something is a myth, there are X number of possible interpretations and so on and so forth. But as you were mentioning, not so much when I was watching it, but as you were mentioning, something that has kind of struck me is that you talk it as Brahmā Manasaputra and Brahmā Manasaputrika.
Correct.
Right? So it is something that has come from the mind continuum of Brahmā. So can it be something, a parallel analogy can be that, like, you come up with an idea and then, like, you feel that it has come from your mind, there is this sense of agency and you are enamored of it. And after a point of time, the thought probably escapes, but you kind of try to catch on to the idea in any which way you can. And after a point of time, it becomes an obsession, and because there is this one possibility can be that Lord Shiva is seen as Kala, as someone who is like time. After a point of time, the continuum can't, like, there has to be an end to it. There's nothing called as continuum. So can it be that, that is one thought that has occurred to me, that it has come to slay that continuum, our obsession of that. And another thing that has occurred is, once it becomes obsession, so there is this like self-protective mechanism where we want to kind of probably we start castigating ourselves, or probably kind of try to really control it, this whole controller, controlled, observer, observed, the whole thing. So I was just wondering, so can it be that, like, again, you said here, for a, this is a surprising thing, that Shiva is put up across as someone who is a son of Brahmā. So after a point of time, even this thought that I should control it is also your own thought, and then it tries to control yourself. And having said that, the kapala is still, it's not complete slave, because this is like a self-deception. So it is not completely slayed. So could it be that is a thought that occurred?
Yeah, matlab, few thoughts, I agree, you know, I mean, working on. But one thing which interests me very much, because Vedic image of the Brahmā is Prajapati, you know. So there is also, like, he is the creator and he is the sacrifice and he is the But what one thing interests me politically, you know, what is the politics between these three, Brahmā and Vishnu and Shiva, you know. And the Brahmā is, removed from the, politics, you know. Now, they are the Prajapatis, you know, which are the actual creators, you know, the producers like Kabir and Julaha and carpenters and, the people who work with the hands or the craftsmen or artists, you know. That interests me a lot, you know. I mean, and I take it very politically, why Vishnuites or the Vishnus, or the Shaivites, Shiva, they survived. And why they made Brahmā as a villain, you know.
I come to know, which is the camera used for this film?
These are Sony cameras.
Sony, not Epic.
Huh?
Not Epic, Sony only. It is good, camera work is fantastic.
Huh?
Mythology apart, what is the, we can say, perception of the foreign tourists visit there, about the place and the Sthalapularana?
They get, because see the, now the, because of the Israelis are coming there, and there is a lot of connection between the Abraham and Brahmā, you know. Now they have a synagogue there, you know. There's a temple of Jews. So there is a dealing between the foreign affair ministry and the Israel or defense ministry. After fulfilling their military services, they come to Pushkar to de-stress, you know. So it's part of the government, something, you know. And they find, very peaceful. And they're lake people. So the people, like people are river people. There is, some people are lake people, you know. The cities which are next to the lake or whose economy is around the lake. So they get attracted to the lake. And of course, the whole lake is like a moon. So it's very hypnotic. But at the moment, it's almost taken over by the Israelis, you know.
So there is this almost near obsession with, this rhythmic movement between showing the macrocosm and fragmenting the image. You have fragmented like every structure that you've seen, you know, there is an enormous sense of different parts that have been fragmented and shown. So can you talk a little bit about that, maybe? I mean, what kind of an image were you trying to change this phenomenology of how you see Pushkar again at this time or with this myth?
I'll take, say, okay, you know, like, I'm going to create an empty Pushkar, or now how it gets filled up. So there is a form in, this is why she's mentioned crowd and the power, you know. So in the crowd and the power, they all talk about the behavior of the crowd in different spaces. So what is the behavior of the crowd in an arena or a closed space, an open space or a circular place or a rectangular place or on a mountain or a height or slopes. So that I have studied, or how in a mass you'll have groups, various small groups, big groups, and what kind of a movement will take there. So I don't just fragment. What I do is that I take a point, a subject, and I'll walk with them and move into a smaller group or a different group. from that I'll see any movement is happening or something is shifting to the other movement. So there is a fragmentation, but I don't go from one image to another image. I have to have one some moving object that takes me to from one space to another. I'll never do one empty one image and cut to and do join them together. I have to have a moving subject which takes you from one point to another. That is the guideline to the camera guy, you know, also. He can't just make a separate composition and say, look, it looks beautiful.
So this thing about the camera movement and the camera looking at movement, connecting spaces, does, like when you were editing the film, and when, like what I felt was that there was this imposition of your fiction or mythology onto the space. But there is also this, there was moments where we were just looking at, we were also felt that we were present into the space. There were accounts of that. So in terms of while we were editing it, how did it came together?
The basic thing is that, that's why my advice to the camera people is always that the frame should disappear. You know, if you want the audience to enter into the film, the frame should disappear. But they look for the frame because the consciousness has no frame. You know, that's why the sound becomes very powerful, because the sound has no frame. There's no cut, you know. Similarly, if you want to reach to the consciousness, you have to see that, you know, like, otherwise people, what they do, they one nice composition, they cut to another composition. So what happens, you see the frames. So the basic thing is, if you can achieve that the frames have just gone and they've disappeared, you know, so it becomes a flux then. So once it becomes a flux, you are inside that, you know. What blocks you in entering into those spaces is those strong frames.
We'll just take a short break, 5-10 minutes, and this is the last session of the festival, which is a conversation with Jabeen Merchant on her editing practice. So do stay. Thanks.
Die halbe Stadt kenne, ja, in der Isar.
Cinema jo hai, pehle hamari srishti ho, par hum uske liye mar chuke hain.
Yeah.